Hello viewers, today I shall be discussing the lesson on asylum. The objectives of the lesson are as follows. Firstly, to enable the students of LLB to understand the development of the law relating to the concept of asylum and the meaning and definition of the word asylum. To make them aware of the principles and rules by which states exercise the right to grant asylum to different categories of persons. To explain to them concepts such as territorial asylum, extraterritorial asylum or diplomatic asylum, asylum in warships and asylum in international institutions. The literal meaning of the term asylum is sanctuary or place of refuge and safety, especially for criminals. In international law, it is more than a temporary refuge, followed by a degree of active protection on the part of the state granting asylum to a person of another state who seeks such refuge and protection. A state may, at its discretion, grant or refuse to grant asylum. This right is an incident of territorial supremacy. Extradition and asylum are closely connected, and very commonly stated that extradition starts where asylum ends. Writers on international law have expressed a doubt whether the right of asylum is recognized by general international law. Since most of the extradition treaties generally refuse extradition of political offenders, the practice to grant asylum is closely connected with the principle of non-extradition of political offenders. Article 14 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, 1948, states that every person has a right to seek and enjoy in other countries asylum. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights, while conferring the right of asylum to individuals, does not impose an obligation upon the states to grant asylum. Similarly, the Declaration on Territorial Asylum 1967 makes certain recommendations to states on asylum. The United Nations Declaration on Territorial Asylum was adopted by the General Assembly, and the declaration called upon governments to refrain from taking steps such as rejecting the persons seeking asylum at the frontier itself. It has been claimed that these instruments do not confer a right to receive asylum. However, humanitarian considerations influence states in granting asylum. The so-called right of asylum is actually the competence of every state to allow a prosecuted alien to enter and remain on the territory under its sovereignty. Such fugitive alien enjoys hospitality of the state which grants him asylum. It is absolutely necessary for him to be placed under surveillance or even to confine him in some place to make his entry conditional. It is an obligation of every state in the international community to prevent individuals living on its territory from posing to the state on whose territory he is alleged to have committed an offense. Any kind of threat or danger to the safety and security of the head of the state, members of its government or its property. Kinds of asylum. Asylum is either territorial or extraterritorial. Territorial asylum is again an incident of territorial sovereignty, and extraterritorial asylum is a derogation from the sovereignty of the territorial state. territorial asylum, granting asylum to all kinds of refugees, including fugitive offenders in its territory, emanates from the doctrine of territorial supremacy. Generally, a state may not grant asylum to aliens on a vessel anchored or sailing in its territorial sea. In the asylum case, the International Court of Justice made a clear-cut distinction between territorial asylum and extraterritorial asylum. According to the World Court, in the case of territorial asylum, the refugee is within the territory of the state of refuge, and a decision relating to the extradition depends upon the normal exercise of territorial sovereignty. In other words, the refugee is outside the territory of the state where the offense was committed, and a decision to grant asylum to such a person does not in any manner derogate from the sovereignty of that state. However, there is no unanimity on the issue whether a state can grant asylum to prisoners of war belonging to a state which has been conquered and who are not willing to be repatriated for fear of prosecution. Territorial asylum is granted by a state on its own territory and is considered as an attribute of the territorial sovereignty of that state. The Convention on Territorial Asylum was signed in 1945. Article 1 of the Convention states that every state has a right in the exercise of its sovereignty to admit into its territory such persons as it deems advisable without, through the exercise of the right, giving rise to a complaint by any other state. In the year 1967, the General Assembly of the United Nations recommended that the states in practice should do the following. Firstly, when a person requests for asylum, his request should not be rejected, or if he tries to enter the territory of such state, he should not be expelled from the frontier itself. But when they come in large numbers, the request for asylum could be rejected on the ground of national security of its own people. Secondly, if any state experiences difficulty in granting asylum, it should adopt appropriate measures by considering it as an international duty through the medium of individual states or the United Nations. When a state grants asylum to the fugitives, other states must respect such a decision of the state granting asylum. Fourthly, political asylum in the case of defectors. Fifthly, refugee asylum in the case of persons who genuinely fear persecution or prosecution in their own country. And finally, general asylum in the case of persons who have fled their country for economic betterment and have no status of immigrants. Extraterritorial asylum. In the case of extraterritorial asylum or diplomatic asylum, the person who is given refugee status is within the territory of the state where he is alleged to have committed an offense. Any decision on the part of the other state to grant diplomatic asylum in the premises of its embassy is deemed to be derogatory to the sovereignty of the territorial state, because it withdraws the offender from the jurisdiction of the territorial state and constitutes an interference in a matter which is essentially and exclusively within the competence of that state. States enjoy certain privileges and immunities on the territories of other states in respect of places such as the diplomatic missions of other states. Extraterritorial asylum or diplomatic asylum is granted by a state outside its territory, such as in its embassy premises or its warships sailing on the high seas or the oceans. As far as granting of diplomatic asylum is concerned, international law does not recognize a general right of a person heading a mission to grant asylum in the premises of the embassy or legation, for the obvious reason that such an act would prevent territorial law from taking its own course and would involve a derogation from the sovereignty of that state. A case on this point is the asylum case or Haya de la Torre case, Colombia versus Peru, 1950, ICJ reports 266. The dispute was between Colombia and Peru in respect of a political rebel leader by the name Victor Raul Haya de la Torre, who was charged with the offense of instigating a military revolt. He was a Peruvian national and was granted asylum in the Colombian embassy at Lima in 1949. The conflict related to the grant of such a diplomatic asylum, therefore, both the parties decided to refer the dispute to the International Court of Justice. The court observed that according to a provision of the Pan American Havana Convention on Asylum 1928, subject to certain conditions, asylum could be granted in a foreign embassy to a political offender who was a national of the territorial state. The question before the court was whether Colombia, as the state granting asylum, was entitled unilaterally to qualify the offense committed by the fugitive in a manner binding on the territorial state, and to decide that it was a political offense and not a common crime. The court was also asked to decide whether the territorial state was bound to provide the necessary guarantee to enable the refugee to leave the state of Peru safely. The court in the year 1950 answered both these questions negatively. Colombia brought a case against Peru, pleading that it has such a right both under the Havana Convention 1928 and the American international law in general. The Colombian government could not prove the existence of any usage or custom. The court also noted such uncertainty and contradiction and much fluctuation and discrepancy in the exercise of diplomatic asylum did not establish the purported Colombian right. Thus, the Colombian claim failed. The court also pointed out that in case of diplomatic asylum, the refugee is within the territory of the state where the offense was committed. A decision to grant diplomatic asylum involves derogation from the sovereignty of that state. However, the court clearly stated that Peru had not proved that Haya de la Torre was a common criminal, and further, the court found favor in a counterclaim made by Peru that Haya de la Torre has been granted asylum in violation of the Havana Convention. The premises of the diplomatic envoys are notionally treated as the territory of the sending state and therefore immune from the jurisdiction of the receiving state. Likewise, a warship has a special status and immunity from the jurisdiction of other states, even in the territorial sea. A person of the coastal state, after committing an offense, may be given refuge in a warship. Such asylum is called extraterritorial asylum. But grant of such asylum is not an absolute right, and rules of international law are not well settled on such asylum. Such asylum may take place in the following ways. Diplomatic asylum. Oppenheim traces the history of diplomatic asylum in ancient practice, where the envoy's residence was considered in every aspect outside the territory of the receiving state and even extended to the whole quarter of the town in which such residence was situated. This used to be called franchise du quartier, and an interference from this was the so-called right of asylum, whereby envoys claimed the right within the boundaries of the residential quarters to any individual who took refuge there. This was opposed by the states, and by the 19th century, the general right to grant extraterritorial asylum vanished, leaving only traces of it in the Latin American practice. Under the Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations, 1961, the premises of the embassy is inviolable and immune from search, acquisition, attachment, or execution. The private residence of a diplomatic envoy is likewise inviolable. The convention, however, does not mention the right of diplomatic asylum. In fact, Article 41, Clause 1 states that it is the duty of all persons enjoying privileges and immunities to respect the laws of the receiving state and not to interfere in the internal affairs of that state. Again, Clause 3 of Article 41 lays down that the premises of the mission is not to be used in any manner incompatible with the functions of the mission. Granting diplomatic asylum is not the function of the mission under Article 3 of the Convention. Therefore, it may be concluded that present international law does not endorse diplomatic asylum. Granting diplomatic asylum has been a common practice among the Latin American states and designated by the treaties between them. For example, the Caracas Convention on Diplomatic Asylum 1954. But it does not seem that any rule of American customary international law has been developed on this. The International Court of Justice has also considered such asylum in the case of Colombia versus Peru cited earlier. It is also suggested by experts that there is an exceptional right to grant asylum on grounds of urgent and compelling reasons of humanity, such as involving the refugee's life being in imminent danger. State practice also supports such asylum. For example, asylum given to the leading Chinese dissident Professor Zhang Lizi and his wife by the US Embassy in Peking in June 1989, who after 1 year was allowed to leave the United Kingdom. Haya de la Torre case, which also arose from the same facts, Peru demanded Haya de la Torre back from the Colombian Embassy. The International Court of Justice, however, held that where asylum in legation premises has been given without justification, the head of the mission concerned is not obliged to deliver the fugitive to the local authorities in the absence of a treaty binding him to do so. Diplomatic asylum has frequently given rise to disputes. For example, after an unsuccessful uprising against the communist government of Hungary in 1956, the US controversially granted diplomatic asylum to dissident Hungarian Roman Catholic Joseph Cardinal Mindszenty, who was given refuge in the United States Embassy, and he remained there for a period of 15 years. Dalai Lama Asylum. Due to the oppressive and repressive policies of China, the spiritual leader Dalai Lama and his followers fled from Tibet and took political refuge in India. China accused India of interfering in its internal affairs. India, on its part, was fully within its legal parameters while granting asylum to Dalai Lama, because India, as a sovereign country, has exercised the right conferred on it by international law. Therefore, there is no violation of international law. Refugees from Bangladesh. The atrocities committed by the military regime of General Yahya Khan and the intentional and well-planned war crime of genocide committed by the military personnel of Pakistan compelled millions of refugees to seek political refuge in India. India had not only granted refugee status, but also proved to the world by providing hospitality, although it was not a party to the refugee convention, and which was unparalleled in the annals of the history of international relations. If not for this great and magnanimous gesture by India, the return or expulsion would have resulted in compelling them to return and to remain in a territory where there was well-founded fear of persecution, endangering their lives or physical integrity. Julian Assange WikiLeaks asylum case. Julian Assange had taken shelter in the embassy of Ecuador in the United Kingdom. The WikiLeaks editor Assange is an Australian and faces prosecution in the United States for allegedly leaking United States classified documents. Assange has also been charged by Sweden of sexual assault. Arrest warrant European was issued for his arrest, and since June 19, 2012, he has been in the Ecuadorian embassy in London. Assange claims that his extradition to Sweden is a ploy to hand him over to the United States. Edward Snowden case. Edward Snowden is an American national who worked for the National Security Agency of the United States as a contractor. He left United States in May 2013 and traveled to Hong Kong and leaked through Guardian and the Washington Post newspapers the covert mass internet surveillance by the National Security Agency of the US. The US has charged him with theft and under the Espionage Act 1917. After he left Hong Kong, he was stuck in the transit area of Sheremetyevo International Airport in Russia as the US canceled his passport. Snowden sought asylum from several countries, including India, without success. In the absence of a passport, he cannot travel to any country. However, he can be granted asylum under Article 31 of the UN Convention relating to the Status of Refugees 1951, as he is a political lead offender. Russia granted temporary asylum to Snowden on August 2013 for 1 year. Russia has granted him a resident permit, and Snowden is in Russia from July 2015. Asylum in warships. Warships enjoy state immunity from the jurisdiction of all states. If a person, right after committing a crime on the territory of a coastal state, takes refuge on board a warship, he cannot be taken forcibly from the vessel. The Convention on Asylum, adopted in 1928 by the 6th International Conference of the American States and the 10th Conference of 1954 recognized the principle of asylum on warships for political offenders, but not for persons accused of common crimes. Asylum in the premises of international organizations. There is a general rule or practice relating to granting of asylum in international organizations or specialized agencies of the United Nations. Some writers are of the opinion that such asylum should be given only in extreme cases where the concerned person's life is in imminent danger, for instance, from a frenzied mob. This view seems to be reasonable in view of the expanding horizons of human rights. The literal meaning of the term asylum is sanctuary or place of refuge and safety, especially for criminals. In international law, it is more than a temporary refuge and protection on the part of the state granting asylum to a person from another state. A state may, at its discretion, grant or refuse to grant asylum. The right is an incident of territorial supremacy. Asylum, when granted, may help persons who are persecuted in their own countries by providing some kind of relief, but when granted to fugitives and criminals, it acts as an impediment to the administration of proper criminal justice in the world. Dear viewers, hope you have enjoyed this session. We shall meet again in the next lesson. Thank you.